This meeting
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Woman Up. I'm Leah, and I'm joined, as usual, by Sue. Hi, Sue.
Hi, Leah. How are you?
Very well, thank you. We are really happy to be joined today by the wonderful Mr. Menno. Mr. Menno has become well-known online for his entertaining and thought-provoking articles and videos, navigating the maddening and insane world of gender identity ideology, or as he calls it, gender woo-woo.
Mm-hmm.
He stands as a voice for those who feel pressured by the new confusing norms that do not resonate with so many, not just gay and bisexual people, but anyone who is deeply concerned with the medicalisation and mutilation of gender nonconforming kids, increasingly changing and dehumanising language, and the disappearance of single-sex spaces and services. Mr. Menno is a proud gay man, unafraid to question and call out the current homophobia that we now find so deeply entwined within what is now known as the LGBTQIA plus community. He approaches the madness around gender ideology with a unique blend of sincerity, compassion, and humour. While celebrating the diversity of the gay scene, he remains critical of the ideology that has completely muddled the waters of sexual orientation and gender identity. And what he does so very well is open up the space where dialogue isn't stifled by fear of misstep. And that's why we love Mr. Menno. And we're really grateful to have you fighting alongside us in this absolutely crazy world that is just feels from day to day just like it's getting even crazier and crazier. Can you take us back and tell us how you first got involved and what piqued you and how you kind of felt like you needed to get your voice out there in a more visible way?
Mm-hmm. Okay, it was quite a slow process. So I think for me, there were very much stages to peaking. It probably took about a year, because before I get involved in anything, and I want to know that I'm sure that I know what I'm talking about. I just don't want to just stick my oar in. So we go back to London Pride 2019. When I'm skipping down, you know, central London in tiny little pink sequin hot pants and semi-drag, if you like, as some kind of caricature of Theresa May. So on the day I was Theresa Gay. And I was there with a Boris Johnson impersonator. And we were leafleting for an organization called LGBT Plus for a People's Vote. So this was a tiny organization that were advocating for a second referendum on Brexit. And I'd done a Theresa May song online. They found me and they said, do you want to come and help us out and be part of this? And I was like, yeah, of course. And I never questioned what LGBT plus meant. Like, I didn't even question it, right? I just went along with it. So looking back on it, it's interesting for me to see how much I just accepted without thinking about anything. So we're there and we met some of the Labour politicians, like Emily Thornberry was shadow secretary of, like, Home Secretary at the time, Dawn Butler, who since I've learned is completely bonkers. I mean, she pretends to be, right? Because she was on she was being interviewed and said something that babies are born without a sex, you know.
Penis, explain the penis reference that you just referred to.
Because biologically, look, when a child is born, they are identified and observed in a particular sex.
Child is born without sex.
Those kind of people I met on the day, yeah. And I was just like, oh my God, an MP. Ooh, exciting. And we're leafleting. And I saw two old blokes in sort of dowdy dresses. And one had a sign that said, proud to be trans. And the other had a sign that said, trans and proud. And I just went, this is fantastic. You know, feel good about yourself. This is who you are. And today is the day that you can just be completely free and happy, all that kind of stuff. And I came from the assumption, which was wrong, but it's a very, it hooks into emotions in a very powerful way. And I think that a lot of other gays and potentially lesbians also come from the same place initially, where they're like, whatever I've gone through as a gay guy or as a lesbian, for a trans person will be 100 times worse. And that's a very emotional place to come from. Mm. And that's where I came from. And so all I wanted was for people like them to just have one day where they could feel free and happy and positive. Mm. So I didn't always go to Pride. It wasn't really a big deal to me. But when I went, I would always go up to a guy in a dress and go, oh my God, you look amazing. You're fabulous. Even if I didn't mean it at all. Mm. So on the one hand, it comes from a very emotional place. On the other hand, it's very, well, for me, it was very superficial. Anyways, that's the reason why I went up to those two. So I've got pictures of us somewhere. And I also took pictures with another guy. I saw a guy and I thought, oh, he's cute. Let's get a picture with him. And then his friend joined in the picture. And I was like, I don't want you in the picture. I just want the cute guy. And then later when I checked the pictures, the other guy who had come in the picture was Sam Smith. I didn't even recognize him on the tape. Anyways, so I had a chat with those two older guys, and they went on their way. And then I looked the other way and I saw a huge banner that said trans women are women. And I just went, uh-huh. Why would anybody say that?
Mm.
And that's just purely from a linguistic point of view. Like, I like playing with language. I like writing parody songs. I like taking language and sort of turning it upside down when it's parody or satire. But I thought, well, this doesn't make any sense because they're not.
Mm.
So just from a very plain sort of linguistic point of view, not thinking about any of the issues. And then I thought, because I can be a bit naive, and I thought, oh, surely what they meant to say was trans women are men who would like to be perceived by society as women. That's what they meant. But that doesn't fit on the banner. So they shortened it, you know? And then I thought, well, wait a second, they're going down Regent Street. They could have made that whole long banner and just, you know, turned and gone down the other direction.
Mm.
But it just made me think, well, that's odd. And also in that group that I was part of at the time, that was just lesbians and gays, right? There was no T involved, even though that was the name, LGBT+. I thought, I'm going to look into this. And then you know how it goes. As soon as you start looking, you're down that rabbit hole.
Yeah.
And what struck me the first was how this affects women and the silencing of women, and Germaine Greer being one example, of course. And me listening to her and thinking, well, she's talking perfect sense.
The thing is, being without a penis doesn't make you a woman.
No, say that again.
Any more than being without a womb makes you a man. We're using very crude measurements here. The thing that gets me about what we have to endure in our culture every day is the caricature of womanhood. Mrs. Brown's Boys, how can this be the most popular television show in this country, shown twice on Christmas Day? You're going to tell me that middle-aged women, old women, are not regarded in this culture as less than human?
So let me just pin you down on this point. A man, in your view, has to have a penis and a woman has to have a womb?
No, not at all.
So explain what you meant by if you lop off your dick and wear a dress, doesn't make you a fucking woman.
Well, it doesn't make you a fucking woman. It makes you a man without a cock.
Right. Let me put that to you.
You know, it may not be the most eloquent way of speaking. It's quite direct. But then again, I quite like that about her.
Yeah.
And just because you lop off your dick doesn't mean you're a woman. Duh. And yeah. Then I discovered Magdalene Burns. And then I also discovered Riley J. Dennis, who now lives in Australia, right? And I'd never heard someone speak such utter nonsense. And like the complete bonkerness of it all. So on the one hand, I found women talking perfect sense. Then I found a lot of blogs talking absolute rubbish. And just, it was the entitlement and the vindictiveness that came with it. Mm. So, and the crazy, the utter craziness where you had that bloke who wanted to get his balls waxed and then took legal action in Canada, right?
Yeah.
What's his name? Jonathan Yaniv.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, this is completely mental. And then Morgan Ogier, who now calls himself the mother of his children, mm. who then campaigned to have city funding taken away from Vancouver rape relief.
Mm.
And I thought, well, surely you don't need that much to go, hang on.
Mm.
So I saw more and more of that. And I just thought, this is mental. Then I started realizing, but I was still a sort of like a spectator at the time.
Mm.
But then there came a shift for me where I thought, hold on a second. You know, when I learned about the puberty blockers, I thought if you were 12 today with a smartphone and TikTok, now you'd be banging on the gender clinic's doors.
Mm.
And then your parents would say, no. And then I'd go, oh my God, you're transphobic.
Yeah.
Mm. And then I'd find the online spaces. And before you know it, I would have known what to say to a GP or whatever else to get a referral. So that's when it became more personal. But then there was one moment where I was given a leaflet for a gay men's weekend workshop.
Mm.
And it was all about gay men being able to get together and to have a space where they could explore like childhood issues, things that you've internalized from a very young age that you've never had that you've never dealt with or got over with, and that are now influencing your life in a way that's not helping you be happy. And some people think, oh, that's a bit wanky, but I really like that stuff, and I think it's very important because it's in those early years where you pick up so much that can get into your system. So I see the leaflet and I'm like, oh, that's right up my street. And then I turn it over and then I read something that just made me go. And it was given to me by a therapist, right? It wasn't his workshop, but a friend of his was running it. And he thought, oh, that'll be something that I'd be interested in. So let's give it to Menno. Okay. So him being a therapist, he sees my face and me go. So he's like, well, what was that? And I'm like, I didn't even realize I did it. So then I read that line again. And it basically, I'm looking at the leaflet and at the back, it says, this workshop is open to anyone who identifies as a gay man.
Mm.
And that something snapped in me when I saw that.
Mm.
And I didn't quite understand what happened in that moment. And neither did the therapist who'd given me the leaflet. And I just started raging.
Mm.
For a good hour, I was just screaming my head off and swearing and crying. And he's like, what on earth happened? And it took me a while to understand what that was. And it wasn't until I found the website Peak Trans by Maria McLaughlin, where she talked about peaking, and I thought, oh my days, I peaked with a bang in that moment, yeah. Right? Like a volcano erupting. It was something so visceral, and it's hard to put into words, but it's just the idea that the thing that you are, right? And you've never asked for it, but it's just the way it is. I am a gay man. It's just how it is.
Yeah.
And I'm only a gay man because I'm male and I'm exclusively attracted to other males. On top of that, I'm a particular type of guy, you know, I'm a bit, and it's always been very obvious and I've never been able to get away from it, even when I didn't even realize that I was gay. So I got bullied for it from a very young age, you know, beaten up. Lots of experiences. So there's lots of experiences over the years that have compounded that are all going back to one being male and one being the kind of male I am and being a male who's attracted to other males, you know, and then being told, oh, you're too girly, you're too effeminate, you're not really a man, you want to be a girl, don't you? You want to be a woman, blah, 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 blah. All that stuff is absolutely 100% unique to my reality. And then here you have that they're saying anyone can just step into it and be the same and pass themselves off as what you are when they are the opposite. It's like, it's like invasion of the body snatchers. It's something comes along and it tries to dig its hands into your skin and move into your body and inhabit you and then pass itself off as just as real as you. And there's something really, I can't find the word for it. It's just so, so invasive and it's so oppressive, but most of all, it's false. And that's what really gets me about what's happening today.
And not only that, we've got a government that's telling us we've got to accept their reality and making it illegal for us to even talk about it.
This is, it's awful. The whole thing is so awful and so dark and so twisted that basically I needed to come down from those six, you know, it took about 6 months to calm down from it. But to me, it felt like a metaphysical rape, you know, and I know that's a very strong thing to say, but that's, to me, that's the closest way of describing it. And I don't use that last word casually. I mean, I've been there. I know what it's like to experience that physically. And this feels very similar. But it's worse because everybody tells you it is real.
Yeah.
And then I thought, I need to do something. I need to do something. I can't just be quiet about this. So I put together an Instagram page called Question the Mantra. And I was figuring out, well, how can you say something in this climate, right? Without being shut down or... And so I did it anonymously and I just created a series of artworks, if you like, that were all about questioning this mantra, trans women are women. And by posting this stuff, I then started talking to others on Instagram and connecting, sort of, and exchanging views and thinking, okay, there's others pushing back. And then I thought, I should do a PhD in this. And then I thought, well, that's going to take like 2 years. And who's going to read it? And then what? I thought, nah, you got to do something quicker. And then I went to Speaker's Corner, or what we now call Let Women Speak in London. That was August 2020, I think. 3 years ago. And as I left, I was nervous, right? And I thought, why are you scared? You're just going to listen to some women speak in the park? But I was scared to be seen. I was scared that people would somehow see me on the live stream and then go, ew, you're a bigot, you're a phobe, you're a this, you're a that.
Yeah.
And then when we were there, there was this Black Lives Matters parade that went past, like, and we're like, okay, and some had signs about trans, and they started laying in on the women and being really aggressive, and some of them took one of the signs away from the, like, one of those pull up banners. They stole it and tore it apart.
Mm-hmm.
So that was an introduction to the other side and how they behave in real life.
Mm.
And then I was like, okay, you know what? I'm in. We're going to fight this bullshit.
Yeah.
And then I heard about International Pronouns Day, and I thought it was a joke. And it was real. So I thought, I'll just do a little song about that. And then I've not stopped since. But the idea was to have a YouTube channel that focused specifically on gay men and mental health. And I did one video for that, but then this just completely took over.
Yeah.
Mm. So there you go. That was a bit of a long-winded way.
Yeah. One of the things that really got me was watching Susie Green's TED Talk. And I thought, this is great, because people are just going to watch this and see how ridiculous it is. Not even ridiculous, sinister.
I had a very sensitive, quite effeminate little boy who was probably gay. But Jack's dad did not approve of our child's effeminate behaviour. And it creates such tensions that we ended up in couples counselling. We went to couples counselling, and what they said to us as parents, that we had to agree. No matter what it was that we agreed upon, we had to agree. At that point, Tim decided that I must agree with him, apparently. And all the girl toys, all girly toys as such, were taken away and put away, and Jack was made aware that this was not appropriate. And a suddenly confident, happy little boy became quite quiet, withdrawn, very clingy and tearful. I didn't like it, and I didn't think it was right. And really, for me, the point at which I really put my foot down was about a few weeks later, I think, and my mum phoned me and said, "What's going on with Jack?" And I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "Well, I phoned a couple of days ago to ask what Jack wanted for Christmas, and he took the phone out of the room and said, 'Can you buy me Barbie Rapunzel? But can you please hide it? Because if mummy and daddy find it, they're going to take it away.'"
It was so dark, that whole TED Talk, basically talking about her gay son and how her husband was so homophobic that the easiest life for him would be to transition. But
it's
people
interesting
thought,
when you're gone.
But people think that it's the compassionate thing to do for a child. I can't get my head around it.
Well, I listened to that and I didn't get that straight away.
Mm.
It's when I heard Kelly J do her reaction to, or her give her interpretation of it. That's when I went, So I think it's easy to get lured into this thing of, it's just the mom wanting to do, you know, the best for her child. Now and obviously she's taken it down, but I've got a copy here and I want to use it for something, obviously. There's also this other side of how she's trying to push her son to be this gorgeous model, this gorgeous female model. And it's like, you know, there's something else going on there. And she tried, but she failed because, you know, she got a documentary out of it years ago when her son was trying out for the Miss England competition and got into the finals. And it was all about, "Oh, you're such a beautiful girl. You're such a beautiful girl." And it's like, this Susie didn't just want to have a daughter. She wanted to have a daughter that she could show off. Even the photos that she uses in that TED Talk are all about Jackie being gorgeous and glamorous and, you know, on the beach with, like, you know, the cleavage showing in a tiny bikini. And it's like, there's something else going on there.
I think people have forgotten that there are mothers who are psycho, you know, or Munchausen. Like, they still exist. These kind of people, and any parents, fathers and mothers, but I think
Well,
they haven't gone anywhere.
There's a British guy who keeps, I don't know his name, but he keeps showing off his son on TikTok, all these little videos where you know, you've got this little boy completely believing he's a girl, constantly waving a trans flag around, and the dad keeps asking him like stuff about how much of a girl he is, or you know, stuff along those lines. It's all about reinforcing to the child, yes, I'm a girl, I'm a girl, I'm a girl, and I'm a real girl. And and why would you turn your child into an activist? I mean, come on, what the hell is wrong with you? And that's another aspect of it. They don't just want to, you know, want to have a trans child. They want the trans child to become famous, or to be some kind of icon of the movement.
Yeah,
like the one that, you know, got his son, her son to do a catwalk at New York Fashion Week or something. And then it becomes news, you know, first transgender child model. Yeah. And it's like, he's a boy. And he's not even nice looking. It's like, why the hell is he on the run of his son? But if you're going to talk fashion and model, then duh. You know?
Yeah.
And it's, oh, it's so dangerous, because what happens with these children, when you're force-fed that, you know, and I say force-feed, but, you know, you're told this stuff and it's constantly being reinforced. Even if it started with the child going, I think I'm a girl. But if they believe that, then how can they ever conceptualize the world along reality and the fact that they are male and that that means something? Because how, like, Jackie, what is he now, 20, 22, 23 or something? How is he ever gonna, what, I wonder what's worse, him living a lie for the rest of his life or finding out or peeking?
Yeah, imagine that. How could you forgive your parents?
And I watched a video the other day, but and I might do a video on this and call it the forgotten trans child. So this is somebody called Ellen Stevenson, who actually was one of the, in the UK, one of the first to medically transition. So just like maybe a year or 2 years after Susie Greenson. And I found a video of him the other day, which is, it's from a few years ago, where he's been, and I was just like, wait a second, you were born a boy? You know? I thought, no. And in the video, he's 20, but he's got a very light voice. And I'm like, you never went through male puberty. Your voice never broke. Something, you've been on the blockers. But then I checked. I'm keeping like a massive timeline so I can track everything, and I'm plotting stuff. So I'm like, wait a second, the Tavistock didn't offer puberty blockers to under 13s at that point. So where did you get your blockers if you are in the UK? And then I listened to a bit more of the video, and he goes, and then, you know, my parents found mermaids. And I thought, oh, God.
Whoa.
And then he goes, so we couldn't get the blockers in the UK, so we went to the States. And I'm like, yeah, I know exactly where you went. You went to Norman Speck, who was the same one who put Jack on the blockers.
Yeah.
And not just on the blockers, but also experimented very, you know, with the combination of estrogen and blockers at the same time, which went again, against all guidelines, which went against the Dutch protocol. So these are just mad scientists who are tinkering, right? Because they can, they've got the tools. And in his TED talk, he says, which is just as disturbing as Susie Green's TED talk. He also says, I know how hormones work. I know how it works in the body. That's all he cares about. And he'd worked with, you know, adult trans people. So he just thought, well, wait a minute, I can make their life easier as adults if I do this to them now as children. So it's pure out and out experimentation. So Ellen then went to the States as well. Susie Green had to remortgage her house, and she spent about £15,000 over 3 years on the drugs and the flights. Alan also said, oh, my parents had to remortgage their house and cash in on other things in order to be able to afford it. So it's the exact same journey, right? And then the other thing is, this kid got bullied so badly for being a girly boy. And, you know, everybody started was calling him the gay kid, but, you know, in less friendly terms. So you've got a sensitive little boy getting bullied so badly. And he apparently was the first one in the UK to socially transition in school. So this goes back to like 2007 or something. Then the press shows up at school and it becomes a big thing. I haven't been able to find any articles on it, but he's talking about how, you know, that was very intimidating for him. So none of this is helping with the issues that he already has. Then he goes to secondary school. The bullying gets so bad, he ends up in a psychiatric unit for a year. Wow. While he's in the psychiatric unit, he's still getting the blockers. Blockers, now we know, can exacerbate you know, your mental health issues and destabilize you even further. So how was it even ethical for him to get those blockers while he was in a psychiatric unit as a 12 or 13 year old? Anyways, he then went on the estrogen, and now he's in his early 20s, and he does voluntary work for Mermaids, and his mum does voluntary work for another trans organization in Brighton, and he's utterly convinced that he's a woman because he doesn't know anything else, really. Yeah. So we're going to have a whole, and the thing with him is, you can't really tell. At least I can't, you know. I think most of the time you can, but sometimes you can't. And especially if a kid has been on the blockers and then the estrogen. I mean, you see him standing next to his mom and then suddenly he looks much bigger and taller. But there's nothing in his voice. And then I really wonder where in society does someone like him fit in? And he stopped doing videos. And again, because of his history of mental health, there's an issue for that. But then he started making new videos, and it's all about him doing drag. And I think, you're just...
My God.
A very flamboyant, sensitive, gay guy who loves drag. Yeah. But now you've got no penis. Because, you know, they took his off quite early on as well.
My God.
Well, 18, I guess, because that would have been the earliest in the UK at 18. So it's such a mess. And kids and young people like him are being used for the validation of oh, I really want to swear.
You can swear.
Yeah.
For a fucking asshole like Roxy Tickle.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Who sits there on TV and literally says, I'm a woman. End of story.
Yeah.
Roxy, you're a transgender woman from regional New South Wales. You played hockey for 10 years from when you were 16 years old, but you stopped when you were 26. Why?
Something didn't feel quite right. And it has taken me decades longer to look back and try and dissect that and understand that I really didn't like being in the male changing rooms. I felt really uncomfortable there. I didn't like the smells or the sounds.
You stopped playing hockey for almost two decades. What was that period for you like without sport?
I stepped back from a lot of society. I had less friends than I should have. I didn't exercise. I've been overweight for most of my life. Not being able to play team sport, it really takes you away from community.
You started transitioning in your late 40s. How did people respond?
I had a bunch of people say, ah, that makes sense. Or, yeah, okay, I see that now. I did have some friends that didn't really take kindly to that, and some of my family really struggled with it as well.
2 years later, you started playing on a women's softball team. What was that like?
I actually didn't know whether I was allowed to play or not. So I ended up talking to the Australian Sports Anti-Doping Authority, as it was at the time, talking to the local organisation that was running the Masters Games, talking to a whole pile of people trying to work out whether legally I was allowed to play, until everybody said, yeah, you're fine.
You now play for East Lismore Hockey Club. How important is that team to your life?
I'm actually not sure if I'd still be around if it wasn't for them. They're all just so wonderful.
Carol.
You've got the suffering of these children being used by entitled, narcissistic assholes like him.
Mm.
They do seek a lot of validation through these kids. So
you need the trans child, don't you?
Yeah, because that's the ultimate validation.
Child. Yeah. If the trans child wasn't a thing, then the whole ideology would come crashing down like a house of cards.
Yeah, it would.
But at the same time, I believe that that's the mistake that they've made.
Mm.
Strategically, and that's where this is all gonna fall down, and we're seeing that now with the puberty blockers, with all the, you know, various countries in Europe at least going, hold on. And I think there was even a clinic in Australia that started saying, hang on a second. And as all this stuff, I mean, we know about this stuff because we look at it, but you know, most people don't. But if you have systemic evidence reviews, which are the most thorough expert, you know, evidence reviews, if they're saying in Sweden, hold on, we haven't got the evidence to back this up. If they're saying the same in Finland, if they're saying the same in the UK, now Norway and Denmark are also going down the same route. And in France, they're urging caution. And if, even if this in the States, the FDA slaps more warnings on Lupron. If that's 2023, if we don't have the evidence in 2023, why were we giving this stuff in the early 2000s?
Yeah.
Because then you know that it wasn't based on science. So then it's based on something else.
Mm.
You know, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to understand that. So that's either blokes like Norman Speck going, ooh, I can tinker with this stuff. Or it's purely money, profit-driven. I mean,
it's all of it. It's
nothing new.
It's a combination of all that. You know, you got these medical professionals, they're just disgusting the way they're just using these experiment.
Well,
look at the decent ones are being suspended. The decent,
passionate
healthcare professionals are being literally suspended from their jobs for speaking out about this.
Yeah, we've got Jillian Spencer. Have you heard of her? Jillian Spencer, she's a senior child psychiatrist from the...
Yes, I saw her the other day in a feature by an Aussie channel.
You've been labelled transphobic. How do you relate to that?
I see this as a really serious child protection issue. And as a 45-year-old woman and as a mother and as a child psychiatrist, I could not hold my head up if I didn't speak about this. It's too important. And what we're talking about is the well-being of children and their health. We want kids to grow up and be happy. We all want that. We don't want them to have regrets and serious health problems.
Why do you think this has become such a significant social issue?
I think there's lots of social factors contributing. There's a very vocal social movement. But what this issue has revealed is a crisis in the published medical research. And so journals usually use a peer review process to determine if a study is accurate before publication, but that peer review process is failing. And so we're seeing very poor quality studies being published, and the conclusions drawn by their activist researchers are often the exact opposite of what the study has found. What parents really need to know is that it's a very dangerous time for children and families, and they need to be very cautious about who they let engage with their child. So what I would recommend is that they see the health professional first without the child to find out what approach they're going to take towards their child.
And they also interviewed a psychiatrist guy who is very much batting for the other side. By that, I mean, not the way that I bet for you. and he came on, and was it 7 News or something? Or
Spotlight,
something?
I think you're talking about.
Spotlight, yeah. And he came in with already preconceived ideas about why that show was being made and why he'd been asked on. So he came in quite combative. And I don't know too much about the background of Spotlight, but I'm guessing that this psychiatrist, who think of them as right-wing or tabloidy sensationalist. Mm. And the answers he gave about, oh, this is all fine, and, you know, all these detransitioners, whatever. Mm.
I think, you know, your argument about the majority is really heartless.
I don't agree. I've got my heart for the people in any medical situation who might find themselves harmed by medical care is the same for those who've benefited. It's not heartless at all. It's heartless to ignore the great majority of people who've benefited.
No, you just accept. You just accept that there are casualties on the side of the road.
Do you accept? No. Do you accept from any surgical procedure that something may go wrong?
I don't accept that children have
to... Ever had surgery yourself?
Yes, I don't accept.
And did you accept there was a risk?
I don't accept that children have to be put at risk unnecessarily.
If a child has a surgical procedure for appendicitis, a surgical injury, is that an unreasonable risk?
Well, that's because the organ has already failed.
So if this situation arises, a kid's mental health, their life is in danger, they're really distressed, their development's in danger, doing nothing is fine?
But there's lots of ingredients in that cake. You know, so why don't you look at the whole cake?
We do.
Professor, I think we've been quite courageous actually airing those people's stories because no one is listening to them. People like you kick them to the curb and say, well, the greater good, too bad,
no,
too sad.
And that's entirely untrue and also unfair. It's an easy, sensationalist thing to say.
Well, I'm quite happy for you to call me a, you know, tabloid media sensationalist scumbag. I couldn't care less.
That's a very interesting characterisation of yourself.
I'm interested in the future of the children here in Australia, Professor.
All the children? Where are all the children who've done well?
The children who have done well, fantastic.
Where are they?
But what
where
about,
are their parents?
What about the casualties?
Where are their doctors?
You just completely ignore the people who fall through the
cracks. We do not ignore, and I don't personally ignore.
We can play verbal gymnastics all day long.
I meet with people all the time. I'm quite happy to meet with, and I do meet with, and talk with people all the time who've been on all sides of this debate.
It's just, and he's a psychiatrist.
Mm-hmm.
He should know about the human mind, right? Yeah. And this is, everywhere you look at this, it's dark.
Mm.
You've got the very people that should be looking out for people's mental health, almost denying what psychology is, you know? <Yeah. laughs> And like with Norman Spack, he put Jackie Green on the blockers before he had even sold the idea of using blockers into Boston Hospital and then open the gender clinic for kids there. So when you start plotting things on a timeline, you're like, you really see how unevidenced things are and how they try to put things in like on a purely experimental basis.
Mm.
So because I first assumed that Jackie was put on the blockers when Boston Hospital had already agreed, yes, this is a treatment that we will, you know, use at this hospital. No, it was all just before that. And I found this German endocrinologist, and he wrote a paper where he literally writes in the paper by putting a child on puberty blockers when they're only 12, you might cement in their mind the idea of what they are, and in doing so, prevent a homosexual development.
Mm.
You know, these are the actual words he wrote in it.
Mm.
And then he goes, there's a lot of debate about this, but I'm willing to take the risk.
Oh, he's willing to take the risk.
And it's like, well, how are you taking the risk? And then, he writes in writing, in black and white, in plain English. He's like, a homosexual outcome might be, you know, I'm paraphrasing, right? But he uses the term homosexual development. You know, if that's the outcome, then you can dispense with all the medication and the surgeries. Plus, he acknowledges that someone who, you know, ends up being gay can then enjoy a healthy sexual life with their own body as it is.
Mm.
And still, he says, but I'm willing to take the risk. Obviously, he doesn't take any risk. Mm. And he's the one who put Kim Petras on the blockers at 12.
Mm.
Well, if you look at government, you look at the medical industry, no one's taking a risk. It's all on the child, like the parents. But this will all backfire and they'll all get sued. But it doesn't make up for ruining these kids' lives.
No. And there's there's one guy that I've just been looking at. His name is Giancarlo McEvenew. He started practicing in Canada. I think the clinic was called McCain or McLean. So here's an older man whose clinic he joined, where they saw such an increase in young girls wanting to have their breasts removed. And he even shows a graph in a presentation saying, oh, look at the increase. And he plotted on it when Facebook became a thing, when Instagram became a thing. So he's plotting the social media, you know, rise alongside the rise. And he's not putting, well, he's probably put them together, but not in the way that, you know, he wants to tell us. He's showing the influence of social media. And then he just goes, oh, you know, we have a 2-year waiting list. Yay, we're doing such great work. We need to train other surgeons. Not asking, but what is behind this? And then he went from the UK to the States, I think Miami, because, you know, it's much more relaxed over there in terms of what you're allowed to do. And he's the guy, you've probably seen this picture where he's pictured holding up buckets of breast tissue with a big mm-hmm. smile on his face. Yeah. That's him.
Yeah.
He goes to Pride with his team and walks around with a shirt that says top surgeon.
Oh, God.
Because obviously at Pride, he knows that that's where the most vulnerable girls are.
My God.
And I just think it's absolutely sickening. Mm. The guy whose clinic he trained at, McCain or McLean, that guy also has a stand at Pride. He has his own stand to advertise top surgery at Pride. And then he's pictured there with women who've had their breasts cut off. So they're standing there topless, all smiles with their scars. And you've got the surgeon in the middle. And it's like, people can't, you see, this is pure business development. This is marketing. He's looking for breasts to slice off in the place where you find the most vulnerable girls and young women.
I can't believe that this is happening.
It is so dystopian. And then in Germany last year, or it was this year maybe at Pride, they had massive signage all over this, I think it was Berlin, Pharma for Pride.
Oh my God.
Hashtag Pharma for Pride in rainbow colors, right? And it's got the name of this, one of the five biggest pharmaceutical companies sponsoring it, and to even use the hashtag Pharma for Pride. This is not Pharma for Pride. This is Pharma for profits.
Yeah.
They're purely making money off the back of severely distressed young people.
Yeah.
And how many of them would have simply grown up to be lesbian or gay?
Mm.
And this to me is just something I just can't get over how twisted and dark and sinister and dystopian that is.
Mm.
So I watched this Giancarlo McAvoy being part of a panel. It's a few years ago, but I watched it again yesterday because I want to use some bits for a video I'm working on. This panel, by the way, was sponsored by John. It's at a university, but it's sponsored by Johnson & Johnson, another big fat pharmaceutical company. The guy hosting the panel is from Johnson & Johnson. And as he introduces Giancarlo McAvoy, he said, Giancarlo is one of our clients because Johnson & Johnson supplied Giancarlo's clinic with the tools and the equipment he needs to carry out his surgeries. And then Giancarlo was asked by someone in the audience, what do you think about age, you know, and is there like a, should there be a minimum age for these surgeries? And Giancarlo says, no, we should just take it on a case-by-case basis because everyone's an individual.
Mm.
And it sounds, oh, yay. This is, again, it's just market development. Mm. It's just making your market, your potential market size bigger.
Yeah.
And it's so blatant. They're saying it. You know, here's the talk.
But isn't it amazing, though, that we have governments that are pushing this as well?
Mm.
It's just mind-blowing that we've got governments that just...
Yeah.
In Australia, is the healthcare system centralised, like in the UK and in places like Sweden? Like in the UK, we have the NHS and the bureaucracy is all centralised. So all the directives and the guidelines are centrally determined and then put out there.
Yeah,
similar in Australia.
It's completely the opposite. Yeah. It's the opposite, right? And that's why it's the Wild West over there. What's it like in Australia?
It's very similar to, I'd say, what's in the UK.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's similar, but not the same. I mean, you'll go to the GP and you'll pay a fee, maybe $40. Okay. I'm talking from just not a private healthcare or anything like that.
It's free.
But I have, for instance, when I had my last baby, I had her completely free.
Yeah, but that's changed recently.
You get, okay.
Oh, God.
So in a way, I mean, with everything that's happening in European countries where there's a pushback and there's restrictions being put in place, purely because the science doesn't stack up, that must then have a ripple effect that will reach Australia at some point.
Yeah, and I know that it's unbelievable because this issue has been brought up in federal government and in state governments and they just completely ignore it. They just, like Maura Deeming put up a motion in the Victorian government a few weeks ago and voted down. And federally, the same thing has happened. So whenever there are brave enough politicians to stand up and then speak about what's going on overseas, it's Labor and the Greens vote it down every single time.
It's maddening. It's maddening to be a part of this because the woman who's pushing this in Queensland, who's for men being known as women, is our minister for women.
Let's be inclusive. Anyone that identifies as a woman is a woman. And as the Minister for Women, I take a really inclusive approach. And we want to govern for all Queenslanders, but all people who identify as a woman are part of our policies and strategies to advance gender equality, because gender equality is inclusive. You know, it's not one group advancing at the expense of another. Let's be inclusive and bring everyone with us.
Yeah.
And she's also the Minister for Health. She has two job titles that are completely inconsistent with what she's doing to health and women. It's absolutely mental. And she's blocked us from even contacting her. She blocks our email addresses.
Yeah.
She blocks us from social media. It's like...
What is it about someone like her that is... Because you can't be blind. You cannot be blind to this. Especially what's happening worldwide.
Mm.
and the pushback.
Mm-hmm.
I
reckon they're psychopaths. They just don't care. And I think it's all about that they think it's going to progress their career. Because I can't understand that they don't care enough to stop this, that they're actually advocating for it. Mm-hmm. And the aggression and the arrogance they show towards anyone that want to speak to them about mm-hmm. it. I did meet with Shannon Fentiman, who's the Minister for Women and Health. I met with her in February because she's my local MP, and it took me months to secure a meeting because she won't meet with any women. But I did, and I took a friend with me, and she was condescending and arrogant towards us and made out that she didn't say we had mental problems.
But here we are, right? She would sit next to Roxy Tickle and go, oh, you're such a lovely lady.
Yeah.
And she would say that you're the one who's got the issues and that you might need to see a therapist. I mean, the gaslighting is off the scale. So I'm so grateful in a way that your group exists and that you're doing this because it, you know, it's going to take a long time. You know, this is like a long haul type thing because these people need to be, other people need to be taking up those positions who are people with integrity and common sense.
Yeah.
They should be Minister for Health and Minister for Women. Not disingenuous lying scumbags like that.
Yeah.
I mean, because they are, because it's 2023. You can no longer say, oh, I wasn't aware.
Yeah.
Those days are gone.
Yeah.
So one question that I had for you was, I'm in London, so it's a big city and there's loads of people and it's easy to organize events. And Brisbane, I guess, is one of the bigger places in Queensland, but still there's so much distance between, you know, I remember when I was in Australia and you'd go like, okay, we're going to the next place. How long is it? 15 hours on a coach. What?
Yeah. And you're still in the state.
Yeah.
Right, you know, and I'm from the Netherlands. So, you know, it takes 3-4 hours to leave the country if you start all the way at the top. How does that make it harder to organize in Australia?
Yeah.
Or particularly where you are.
Yeah, it is far more difficult in Australia because of the distance. And the problem is the fear that people have to speak out. We've got not only the distance but the fear factor in trying to encourage people who really feel so strongly about this but, you know, they're worried about losing their jobs.
Yeah.
So, you know, you've got people that haven't got anything to lose that are the ones that sort of speak out. Because everyone's afraid. Because we've done quite a bit of outreach protesting, like at the children's hospital and things like that. And we know from if we get the public support, very few people abuse us. So we've been able to gauge that the public here, it's probably over 90% don't agree with it, but they're too afraid. But the thing is, you know, when you look at the kids, people have to be. And I can understand it too, to a certain extent. You know, if it's a livelihood and they've got a family, they've got a mortgage.
Yeah.
Because that's the punishment, is if you speak out, they will get you in some way.
Yes. I mean, and that's a very real prospect. And especially when you have self-ID in place, which you now have in Queensland, right?
Yeah, it hasn't come, it's been passed. But I think it's the 1st of January next year, but doesn't make any difference
if
reality practice, because they're doing it now. Yeah.
Yeah. And is that the first state in Australia that's got both, or are there others?
No. Most of Australia's got it now.
Oh, God.
New South Wales is the only one that hasn't, but they're now considering the bill to introduce it. So
they don't want to be seen to be, you know, the last one.
Yeah. But each tries to outdo other states in making it worse for people. It's like a gold star if you can make it more severe.
Oh, all right. So they're like, oh, we're not just self-ID, we're self-ID plus.
Yeah. Yeah, and then we've got the hate speech amendments that are coming in. And so I've actually written to the Attorney General giving scenarios of the type of things that we are currently doing. It's so broad. And I've asked whether or not we would be in breach of the hate speech laws by doing what we're currently doing. I don't expect to get a response.
No.
Pretty sure they won't put it in writing.
I mean, it's the same. It's the same shit everywhere, isn't it? It's the same type of laws.
Yeah.
Are you in touch with similar organizations in other places, in other states, in Australia, but also in other countries?
We are. You know, and we watch very carefully what's happening overseas, and we really have got a, you know, a national network.
We do. We have a really group of amazing, mostly women.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'd say that's pretty strong. Wouldn't you, Leah?
Yeah, I would. And it makes me hopeful that this isn't going to last forever, because the women that we've got over here are awesome.
Yeah, like we've got Kath Deves. Have you heard of Kath Deves?
Yes. Yeah.
And we've got Moira, we've got Jillian. Yeah. We've got a lot of, and Rachel Wong.
I met Rachel and Moira at the end of October because they were here on a massive turf tour. And she packed in so much. Like when we met, she had this document on the table, which was like her itinerary document and meetings that she had every day, and it was like a big fat document, and I was like, good for you, right? She wasn't going to waste a single minute of her time in the UK, and all the people that she's met is incredible. So and we're walking down, you know, we're walking through the park and we're just kind of laughing at one point, because sometimes you just have to laugh. Like some of the stuff that we've talked about in this conversation, it's dark and it's heavy, and it's like you wonder, am I crazy? Have I gone crazy? It's like, no, the world's gone crazy, not you. And then like we're just chatting away about, so why did you get involved in this? And just, and then when you listen to each other, it's like you're just talking common sense. It's like, well, a man is not a woman. Duh.
Yeah, it's so nice. It's so nice to have that conversation with someone.
Yeah.
Right. And for me, it's easy to have these conversations, especially here. But I can imagine for Moira coming, you know, from the environment that she's coming out of and then coming here, what a contrast that must be.
Yeah.
In terms of the you know, socially, what you can say, what you cannot say, and how freely you can say things. And the damage that does to people's mental health, I think, cannot be underestimated. There's a group in the UK that's done research into this, so they're going to publish their findings. And I thought, I want to do some research specifically among gay men about how this impacts you. The fact that you know, that you can't talk about yourself without being called a bigot, that you're losing single sex spaces and services. It takes a toll. And this is one of the reasons why I think it's so incredible to have someone like Kelly J. Keene, who just keeps going.
Yeah, she does.
She just keeps going. And, you know, we've all seen those scenes of her in New Zealand.
Yeah, that was
with
shocking.
That mom.
And, you know, in Australia, it was recorded, because Australian media, there's basically a blanket ban. They won't report on anything negative to do with the gender ideology. Except the other day with J.K. Rowling, they reported that when she had words to say about South Australia and, you know, the court system, how they will refer to men that claim they're women, you know. So they reported on that. But at the same time, they were going, oh, this is ridiculous, you know, like trying to make out that J.K. Rowling was, you know, making a
big deal. She's a rich woman in Scotland in a castle, and she should be talking about. She's using her privilege.
And then comments on social media by people, oh, why does she even care? It's not her country, you know, that sort of thing. Anyway, so, but with Kelly J, what happened in Wellington, the media over here said that she had a tomato soup thrown on her, so she left the country. That's how it was reported. Not that she was mobbed by thousands of people and could have died. You know, it was like, oh, look how precious she is, tomato soup thrown on her, and she goes back home, that sort of thing. It's just
disgusting. Yeah. It is. And there was a guy who drew a cartoon of her as a Trojan horse with her face. And then all the Nazis standing in front of it as if she was the Trojan horse for letting the neo-Nazis in. And he tweeted it, you know, the artist. And then I responded to it and I said, well, this is why you're wrong. And, you know, I used to draw a lot. I used to do a lot of satirical cartoons. And I thought, you've jumped on something that's very lazy. It's very lazy to do this, you know, and the drawing looks great, whatever. You're a talented illustrator, but you haven't illustrated the right point, which means you failed as a cartoonist because you failed to pick up on the issue and block, you know, block straight away. And it's the whole thing is mad. And there's a song from the 70s called Super Paradise, which it's super cheesy and tacky, you know, 70s disco. And it's by a Dutch person, Romy Haag, who then moved to Berlin, became one of David Bowie's lovers, and helped David Bowie create the Ziggy Stardust character, apparently. So Romy Haag, born a boy, apparently started growing breasts during puberty, so maybe had like a DSD going on. Who knows? Anyways, but clearly a bloke. So he's in this video and he sort of modeled himself on Raquel Welch, you know. He's got the big hair and a tight corset to show his cleavage. And he comes out, you know, dancing to the cheesy disco music. And then his voice comes out and it's like, wah, wah, wah. And he goes, super paradise coming through, boy or girl, it's all up to you, left or right. In super paradise, they do the sex, chains too. Like, even with like an evil laugh in it. And I thought, well, this is where we are now, aren't we? We're in the trans super paradise.
Yeah.
Boy or girl, it's all up to you. In Super Paradise, they do the sex change too. But a paradise for who? Who is it a paradise for? It's a paradise for the likes of Roxy Tickle. It's not a super paradise for you. It's not a super paradise for the lesbians who can't even have legally their own lesbian only, female only events. They have to do that back, you know, in secret now, so the gays are going back in the closet. It's not a super paradise for the gays. There is a gay club night called Hustler Ball, which is an international club night. It's fetish, so it's huge. It's a massive club event. And it's all about, you know, guys getting their rocks off, basically. It's highly sexually charged. So most guys go in their fetish gear. There are stage shows with, you know, live sex or on stage. And then there's a huge dark room where you can get busy. So this is as gay as it gets. I'm not saying that in the sense that every gay man is into that, but this is about sex. In Berlin, a few weeks ago, they had this, had Hustler Ball. And one of the sex shows was a woman with two guys. And there, you know, obviously she's had her breast removed and she's on testosterone, but she's being used by these two men sexually, you know. And there's penis and vagina sex on stage at a gay night. And they posted videos of this on Twitter, because on Twitter you can post stuff like that. And I just went, I said something along the lines of, oh, penis in vagina sex at the gay night. You know, this is what the gays want to see. And then I just got a response saying, we're delighted that you won't be coming. So, and this, you must get this as well in terms of women's spaces and women's services and the language you use to talk about your reality, is that not only do people try to block and silence you, but also they delight in it. They take a certain delight in it. So it's not a super paradise for the gays. It's not a super paradise for women. It's not a super paradise for the detransitioners. Who is this a super paradise for? A bunch of blokes with fetishes.
And even the government doesn't care about the detransitioners at all. So they've had a couple, you know, you saw Spotlight, you saw Mel Jeffries, and then there was Chloe Cole and Courtney, I can't think of a surname, but yeah, and the government doesn't care about the detransitioners either. Yet when Moira put that motion forward in the Victorian Parliament, there were a couple of detransitioners watching on, and Mel said that the politicians wouldn't even look at her. You know, they just don't want to know about the detransitioners. I just don't understand how there's so many politicians that simply don't care. But that's their job, is to protect the public.
Yeah.
They're not. They're not protecting anyone except the autogynephiles.
And they think they're on the right side of history.
Yeah.
Do you think there will be a time after, when this is all over, that we look back and think that was the time of madness? Or do you just see this as the new normal?
It has to end.
It has to. It's unsustainable, isn't it?
It is.
Sorry. Yeah. I mean, we are seeing a change. We're seeing a change in the UK. You can't get away from it anymore. You can't get away from the fact that there's a huge conflict here and that something's very off. Sorry, I'm just going to mute myself for a bit. I'm nearly at the end of this cold. And as I said earlier, the changes that we're seeing here in Europe, which for me includes the UK, it doesn't happen in a vacuum. It's not in a bubble. This is going to have ripple effects that are going to reach Australia as well, as far away as it is, because you can no longer deny it. So Moira tried to pass the motion. It got rejected this time. You go again and you keep banging on about it until it's no longer necessary.
Yeah.
I mean, I asked this question once at Let Women Speak in London, where I said, you know, how much longer do we have to go on about this? And one woman said, as long as we have to.
Yeah. Yeah, we just can't.
So we're all gonna, and you'll know this, where you have moments where you're like, is this really happening? And no, you're tired and you're fed up.
Yeah.
You got to keep going. And one of the reasons I make my videos, you know, more the sort of the funny ones, is I see it as I'm sort of entertaining the troops here, you know, because every now and then you have to come up for air.
Yeah.
And you have to just be able to just go and to just laugh.
Mm.
To just laugh at someone like Tickle and just go, you're a man. Duh.
Yeah, we've got Sal Grover too, you know, the Tickle versus Giggle.
She is amazing.
Yeah. So that's going to be really interesting to see what happens with the High Court with
And I think it is going to be those kind of court cases. And I don't know which way that's going to go because, you know, Australia's legally already gone so much, you know, into super paradise.
Yeah.
And actually, I found a case in the Netherlands that goes back to 2012 where a woman wanted to organize an erotic evening for lesbians and bisexual women. And she sold tickets for that online. And before the evening, they had a meetup just to, you know, sort of get to know each other a bit and see if it was going to work. And a bloke in a wig shows up. Now, they just saw a bloke in a wig. And he goes, oh, but I've had the surgery. So what?
Mm.
And some of the women were like, well, if you're coming, then I'm not coming. They made it clear they didn't want him there.
Mm.
He still showed up. And that again is that it's that constant putting themselves first that you see with the bloke who had his balls waxed or didn't get them waxed and then threw a hissy fit and started suing left, right, and center. It's with Morgan Ogier in Canada going, you know what? Rape relief, Vancouver rape relief don't recognize that we are women. Mm. Therefore, now I'm going to have the city funding taken away from them. It's Roxy Tickle who just keeps going further, taking it a step further and further and further. Mm. This guy shows up. It's that same motivation. He shows up. And then the guy on the door goes, no, you're not allowed in. And then he, again, took it a step further and went to the what we call in the Netherlands the College for Human Rights, which isn't a college like a school where you go, but that's like the commission, right? The Commission for Human Rights.
Yeah.
And they agreed that he was a woman and that he should have been allowed in.
Mm.
And it's like, so back in 2012, the Dutch law no longer recognized what a lesbian or a woman is. So this goes back a long time, you know. Sometimes you think, oh, maybe it's just the last couple of years that it's sort of accelerated. But this has been in the making, if you like. You know, people ask, how did we get here? Well, just look at the last 50 years. I mean, it goes back further than that. But the last 50 years, this has been put in place bit by bit.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that was done strategically from the start. But you can see it, you can trace it back. There was something I found just the other day, and it's from 72. Mm-hmm. And it's a manifesto for a group of drag queens, transvestite, and transsexuals, right? Those were the three names they used. So they lumped that all together. And they were a specific group that was part of the Gay Liberation Front in the UK. So they were like a chapter of that. And they put a manifesto up, which is called Don't Call Me Mister, You Fucking Beast. So it's like the 1972 version of It's Ma'am, right? And here's their manifesto that basically says, no one can tell us who we are because we know we are women.
Mm.
It literally says it. This is 72, right? Because often I hear people say, oh, you know, old school transsexuals are very different. But it wasn't like you had the old school transsexuals and then the transgenders took over. It was always muddled. Okay, it was never clear cut like that. So, I mean, Virginia Prince. Have you ever heard of Virginia Prince?
No.
Oh. He coined the term transgender because he didn't want to get rid of his dick. You know, that goes back years. And he was part of a small group of blokes who got off wearing dresses. And I'm not saying that every guy who, you know, reaches for a trans identity comes from that place, but plenty of them are. So I think it was in the 60s that it started in the States, right? So much of this starts in the States, that a bunch of these guys would meet up once a year during the summer for a week. You know, they'd hire some, like a bunch of bungalows or caravans, and they'd all hang out for a week and wear dresses and put on shows. And they were very clear that they had to be straight. They didn't want gay men there. They didn't want to be associated with gay because gay was bad. There was one actually who came all the way over from Australia to be part of that, because for them, that was their one week where they could be themselves. And some of them, like one of them was Virginia Prince. He was an attorney. And then they started putting out a network, or creating a network in the States and then worldwide, and had a magazine, Transvestia. And that's how they started organizing, also legally, you know, because they are like, we don't just want to do this once a week in a place far away, hidden from the rest of the world. They wanted it to be their lives. So they started organizing, and this goes back to the 60s.
But it's one thing.
Go on.
It's one thing that, you know, you want to be able to do that and be open with it. It's about the oppression that comes with it. It's like they've got to destroy women, lesbians, and gays, put us all in our place. Yeah.
Everything.
And take away our rights and all that sort of thing. So no one cares how anyone wants to identify.
No, everything has to give way for them.
Yeah.
And some of these blokes were quite wealthy, so they would start paying for the others to have their hormones and their surgeries. You know, so that for them it's super paradise, but for nobody else.
Yeah.
And this is, so all this stuff about, you know, the more I look into this, the more I see that the main talking points have never changed. I am a real woman. I decide. You don't tell me what to do. You don't tell me what I am. And also the fact that they don't want to have a therapist involved or a psychiatrist. They want their medication now, on their terms, bodily autonomy. This all goes back to the 60s. It's the same talking points, right? Yeah. So I'm collecting all these clips from documentaries and documents. Nothing's changed. It's just, what's changed is they got what they wanted. And everything else has to give way.
It's the compelling of the speech and thought, and it being illegal to talk about it in a negative way. They've just completely dominated, and then they claim that they're an oppressed minority.
No, that's the trick.
Yeah.
That's the trick. And you've heard of Martin Rothblatt?
Yes.
Right. He did a speech in either 93 or 94 at the third International Transgender Conference in Houston, where, again, there are a bunch of attorneys in dresses. They hired the Hilton, you know, because that's what oppressed grassroots groups do. They had the mayor of the city putting a huge billboard up saying, "Welcome to the transgender conference," because obviously that's what you get as an oppressed minority group. And he did a talk where he literally says, we need to piggyback, I mean, I'm paraphrasing, onto the women's movement and what he called the queer movement.
Yeah.
So they could be more expedient.
Mm.
So, you know, again, a lot of people say that the LGBTQIA2S+, what the fuck movement, has always been one. No. There were very distinct trajectories of trans and gay. not gay. Gay is no fingers. Gay is proper gay. I don't need the quotation marks. There were very distinctive trajectories, and the T trajectory was quite, you know, keep the gays out because we want nothing to do with them because they're a bunch of perverts, or at the time obviously it was criminalized and all these things. They didn't want to be associated with that. Similarly, you had the Beaumont Society, who were very, and again, they were like, yeah, no gays, please. So most of all, it's straight blokes with a fetish.
Yeah.
And there, but then you get someone like Martin Rothblatt, you know, in the early 90s, saying that in a speech. Basically, we have to piggyback on this, on these other movements, if we are to get anywhere. So it's that hijacking again. And that's the same sense I got with that leaflet, where it says anyone who identifies as a gay man, it's the hijacking.
Yeah.
That just makes me go.
And the brainwashing too. You know, like
everything.
Yeah, these people that, you know,
so we
better that call us bigots and transphobes and.
Well, we now know that that means nothing.
Yeah.
I mean, whatever they say means the opposite. So the way I look at it, is they try to turn the world upside down, we turn it back around. Yeah. Roxy Tickle says, I'm a lady. We say, no, mate, you're a bloke.
Yeah.
I'm a lesbian. No, you're a straight bloke.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what we need to do. We just need to keep strong and just keep pushing.
Because I do think, though, there's a strong international force, you know, because we all seem to know what's going on in each other's countries. And, you know, it's pretty strong that way as well. So,
well, what's good is it's getting more, as it grows, it gets more specific, as in you have groups focusing on what's happening in prisons. You have a separate group focusing on healthcare. You have you've got clinicians getting together now and calling out this stuff. There are some voices, even on the gender side, that have recently started going, maybe we went a bit too far with the blockers. I mean, like Marcy Bowers, who still spouts plenty of bullshit, but at least he's admitted some things now. Somebody else who was quite senior in WPATH has said, you know, what's going on? I think she's Australian, Leaper, something Leaper. It's like a double barrel name with Leaper in it. She's a gender clinician, and she's also going, wait a second, we need to listen to the detransitioners. Like, you can't call yourself a gender expert if you don't acknowledge detransitioners. So, and the more it comes from science, I think, the more is the actual scientist going, stop.
Yeah, well, Gillian Spencer has got, well, she's probably got more now, but she had 75 doctors that have supported her to call. Yeah, so they've signed this letter to go to the health minister, Shannon Fentiman, calling for an inquiry into the gender affirmation model being used at the Queensland Children's Hospital. Shannon Fentiman won't even meet with them. Ignoring them. And this is the health minister.
But that's not going to stop Gillian, right? And that's not going to stop the others.
No.
So the problem that these people in power have is that it cannot be ignored.
Yeah.
So everything they're doing now to ignore it is just going to backfire on them.
Yeah, it will. Yeah, and that's their legacy that they're going to leave.
They're only shooting themselves in the foot. Yeah. So this movement, it's growing. It's growing internationally. It's getting, you know. The problem is the other side had a head start, you know, because they started in the 60s.
Yeah.
But you can't ignore the evidence. You can't ignore reality, and you can't ignore the conflict anymore. And people are getting louder and louder and more better organized. And they're popping up from teachers groups, from clinicians groups, you know, endocrinologists speaking out. So it's coming from all angles.
A few, probably about a month ago, there was a group of Muslims in Sydney, and they got together to march against what's happening to children in the schools. Over 5,000 Muslims got together and marched, and it didn't even make the news.
I mean, this is the thing, like, we can research all we like. Some people just get it, but it's like the same with the Million March in Canada. But there's a danger there that it then, you know, you had a little kid saying homosexuals are disgusting in Canada. And obviously when you get a whole bunch of Muslims together, you know, not all of them are going to be too nice about the gays. And I'm sure you've seen this where, you know, all the feminists and the women get the blame for this super paradise being where we are. Similarly, there's a backlash brewing against the gays, and they're like, you know, it's let two guys get married. That was the slippery slope for all of this, you know, because people simplify things in order to try and explain it. So same with, you know, this whole Queers for Palestine thing that we've seen in the last couple of weeks, which is bizarre. And then in London, one guy had a progress flag, and then some Muslim guy stole his progress flag. And then I'm like, okay, so what's it's obviously good, more people from all walks of life are pushing against this, but that could also mean it goes the other way for gays and lesbians, where it hurts us, you know. And it's, again, one of the other reasons I'm doing what I'm doing is to sort of have some sort of damage limitation. I don't know how much you can do, because when people are against gays, and they're against gays, and now they have an excuse to rail against it, you know, again, openly. So it's a scary time.
It is. Yeah.
It is, but I think we'll get there. Look, thank you for coming to talk to us. We've kept you way too long already. you're not feeling very well.
I never even talked about Australia much.
You've got to come back to Australia.
Yeah.
I would love to. Have you ever heard of Miss Kate?
No.
So I'm going to show this because of the I'm using this. Can you see this?
Yeah.
So that's, I got this from Miss Kate in Cairns in 1999. So in Cairns, there is I guess it's the main street. I mean, there's not much there. There was a place called Jono's Blues Bar. I don't know if it's still there. And it was a fascinating place where Jono and his blues band, they would just play blues. And then some people would go up on stage and do their own thing. And one of them was Miss Kate. So, again, this is the back. Ooh. There she is.
What's she doing?
Well, she's just chucking down some alcohol.
Oh, yeah.
So she would always have this, like, little black leathery dress or an animal print dress. She would always have a whip. I don't know why. Nobody knew why. And she calls herself a bar poet. And she would just be pacing down the stage in quite a menacing sort of way. And then once this drunk woman tried to get up on stage, and she just lashed out and with the whip. And people are like, oh, okay. And then she would recite poetry, like her own stuff. And it always finished in her swearing somehow. And there was just one where she went, because this was the time of Pauline Hanson sort of, you know, first hitting the scene. And she went, Pauline Hanson and her one man, one land. Well, I come from a land where a stubby in your hand unites every woman and man. Drinks for my friends. That's where the story starts and the fucking story ends. And she just made an impact on me. So I bought her album.
Oh.
Where it's her doing a poetry.
Well, Pauline Hanson's still around.
It's like when I saw Kelly J. King doing Let Women Speak in Canberra, and then Pauline Hanson shows up and I'm like, no. But then what she said about women was true. So it's like, you know. I mean, that's the one thing where people say, oh, you're like, to me, they say, you know, the leopards will eat your face because, you know, you're in bed with the right wing. And I'm like, wait a second. I'm just a gay man who knows what a gay man is. Yeah. Like, you want me to worship at the altar of girl dick? Like, is that the choice? Girl dick or someone who wants to kill
you? They do love to. The accusations constantly about, you know, you're right wing and you're an extremist. Like, everyone's a Nazi now.
That's all they
do is throw labels.
Yeah, because they've got nothing else. You know, they're just trying to smear you. Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We've talked for how long?
A little while.
An hour and a half, maybe.
I need to go and have some breakfast. It's 11:45, where I am.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hang in there and keep doing what you're doing.
And you too. We love watching videos.
I've got at least 20 videos on my list.
Excellent. That I need to
make. We appreciate you.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, onwards and upwards.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, and then let's finish on, there's a quote, I think it was Margaret Mead.
Oh, yeah.
Something along the lines of, don't ever doubt that a small group of people can change the world. In fact, it's the only thing that does.
Yeah.
Wow, yeah.
Something like that. And then I'll come back to Australia and then we'll all sing, someday we'll all be together once more.
Looking forward to it.
And we'll have lamingtons.
Thank you.
Ciao,
bye, everyone.
Bye. I'm struggling with the concept of seeing you as a big, bad troublemaker.
Thank you.
Because you want an open-minded approach to this. That's your sin, medically.
Yes. Well, I see this as a child protection issue. I think we need to take urgent steps to figure out how interventions that are so serious and poorly evidence-based have been delivered to children across Australia. And I think that we need to have a federal independent inquiry into the model of care for children with gender dysphoria in Australia.
Do you think you will get your job back or not?
Well, the lawyers seem to think that it's unlikely, but what I've discovered about myself is that I do live in a bit of denial, and I just can't imagine not being back in my office and being with those colleagues that I've been with for years.
Do you want your job back?
I do. Just in my job, I've met a lot of really courageous people, patients, and so I gain inspiration from them. And I try and keep myself happy and strong, and I look forward to walking back in the door of the hospital.
Good luck.
Thank you.